I'm just really, really enjoying all the costumes. I feel like this MCM Expo is very much an anime cosplay event, and it's rough when they look better than you do. You know, everyone dressed up, you're like, wow, they look really good. I should have worn a costume.
What's been the best costume you've seen today, and what would you have dressed up as?
Oh, gosh. Well, I saw a couple of Pikachus that were pretty amazing, but I saw a Harley Quinn that was kind of awesome. I sort of wanted to be her. I play a vampire named Amelie, and she's sort of the... she's large and in charge, I like to say. She sort of keeps everybody in line. It was so much fun to get to work with these guys and to shoot in Dallas, which, you know, I don't think I've shot anything in Texas. This is my first Texas experience. I ate a lot of barbecue. no blood, lots of barbecue. Even though I'm a vampire, vampires like barbecue apparently. But I write books and Rachel Kane and I have the same publisher, and so we would always see each other at events for book stuff. And she was like, "I'm going to do Morganville as a series, and I would love for you to come and play with us." And I was like, "Hell yeah!" And so that's kind of how I got conscripted into Morganville. Well, I was a fan of Rachel's work. I thought Morganville was really smart. And I thought the reason that I felt like it was sort of, first of all, it's very different than Buffy, because Buffy is very much that snarky sort of tongue-in-cheek, super meta stuff. Morganville is much more of like a straight ahead, you know, here's this town, these people are sort of under the thumb of this sort of vampire community. And it's very, there was a reality to it. But I think what was great is that the mythology is a little bit different. And the fact that we have, you know, Ben's character Michael, who is sort of there's a hybridized sort of quality to his vamp, you know, possible vamp ghostly sort of stuff. I thought that was really smart and interesting. And I thought the writing was really good. Rachel adapted the show from her books. And I thought, for me, that is what set it apart, is that it was her voice all the way through, that it was what she wanted on screen from the beginning to the end. And I support that. I think being an artist, you have to own your own stuff. You have to create your own stuff. You sell it to the highest bidder, and you don't know what you're going to get. With Morganville, we knew it was going to be good because it was Rachel's vision. Yeah. There's a depth to it and a thoughtfulness that I think... it's sort of become inherent in YA literature in the past, like, 5 years. It's very much, you know, there's a thoughtfulness to what's being written. A lot of dystopian stuff, a lot of supernatural stuff that does have that moral underpinning, where it is about, like, well, what makes this a strong, interesting character that's flawed yet is searching to become a better creature, person, whatever your protagonist is. And I think you have that in Morganville, that it's not just, like Bob said, decadence. It is there's a moral base to it. It's a thoughtful piece. You know, I think it's just another avenue, another venue for creating content. The stuff looks amazing on the internet now. There's really not a lot of difference between what you see on TV and what you see online. And that's got good, there's a good aspect to that and a bad aspect to that, because you have a lot of stuff now. There's like just too much stuff to wade through. But it also means that, you know, you can do stuff via Kickstarter or Indiegogo or Seed and Spark, one of these online sort of crowdsourcing resources. You can create stuff. Like this Morganville would not have happened without, you know, the fans. They are the audience, and they are also the contributors and the investors, and they are just as involved in the process as we, the actors, are. And then Geek and Sundry stepping in and taking Morganville to the next level was really amazing. Yeah. But